what it's there to do. But the point that I'm making is that when you look at the 12 tribes, and I've been thinking about this for years. In fact, a couple years ago, I actually had joined the 12 tribes at a time when it was going through a lot of transformation. I don't know what happened with my membership, but they was going through a whole big change around them. But the 12 tribes, I've been thinking about this, like, in spite of some of the negative, and we know about, you know, we have different folks that are close and up in different, you know, different levels within the organization that are like family to us, and they've shown us, you know, the good, the bad, and ugly. But overall, they are more progressive. There's more of a balance because they address those nine areas more biblically. And even where they fall short, they still have the glory of God, the Bible, as an anchor. You see what I'm saying? And that identity as Israel, even though it may not touch on the real national dispersion of the racial Israel squarely. You understand? Because it includes more astrological or celestial Israel, using the zodiac or the zodiac on that level, which is a metaphysical dimension that the 12 tribes have shown is operable for organization. You understand? It's operable for organization. So when we look at the Tsar Yaakov, oh, the crown prince level and the monarchist level, the Kabbalist party and that whole dimension right there, when we look at what they're seeking to do, it is touching on the political area. You see what I'm saying? And vis-a-vis Ethiopia, we don't really, most Rastafari are kind of lost when they get to the Ethiopia dimension, dealing with the internal politics and where they really stand. You see, they come in Ethiopia more or less out of kind of a partial vision, but then it's a partial dream, kind of like a eschatological kind of a level, where they, you know, like where they come to Ethiopia and say Zion and expect certain things that they don't find in Ethiopia.
Eschatological
level, you know, like in the prophetic level of the Bible, like where we're going to heaven and Zion, and so they go to Ethiopia expecting to find what they have read in certain parts of the Bible, but they have ignored other parts of the Bible that will clarify why we see what going on in Ethiopia going on.
Alright.
When we get the fullness of it. That's why it's massive, the Bible shouldn't be cut into pieces. So we shouldn't focus on one part to the exclusion of the next part, because when the good days turn bad, the other area of the scripture, it comforts and strengthens and helps us to overcome the negative setbacks. You understand?
Right. And to be aware of what could be coming down the pipe.
Exactly. And what's coming here, the preparation, is to be forewarned, is to be forearmed. So the scripture forearms us in that sense. So the 12 tribes, with the exception, you understand, of certain personal people areas where, you know, certain things go on that people might run as rumors against the 12 tribes, they have a pretty good stance right now. And I think that Rastafari should at least look at the lead that 12 tribes has taken in regard to the Tsar Yaakov claims. And we need to really have some more discussions, I think, on where we really stand, what we want to ask, if we are to support Tsar Yaakov's claims, what should we ask of Lion of Jewish Society? We already know what we would ask and what we do ask of the Crown Prince, you understand, in whatever capacity now, you understand, and if God wills that he becomes, you know, the ceremonial king, you understand, or constitutional king of a future Ethiopian state. In other words, that our dual citizenship be recognized, us being Israel as well as Ethiopia in the covenant sense, being Ethiopian Hebrews. In other words, we need to have our dual citizenship is the most important thing. Our sovereignty and our dual citizenship is the most important thing for the global Rastafari community. And that hasn't been articulated very well by different mansions and different folks in Rastafari, different groups, because they're dealing with a panhandling African approach, post-rebellion Ethiopia, and are not dealing with the present reality prophetically. You see what I'm saying? So we need to, first of all, address that we're Israel. Even if we're not 12 tribes of Israel members in that specific sense, we need to address that. And any Rastafari group or individuals or family that recognize they are Israel and the covenant connection will prosper in those nine areas. You know, because God already promises that we'll prosper when we do it His way. But the whole choice about Zar Yaakov, but the whole decision about Zar Yaakov, I really want to caution a lot of our Rastafari brothers and groups and different folks not to rush to judgment, not to judge anything before its time, and really to kind of like be inclined to the fact that we should not be against the establishment of a monarchy, because if things had not turned the way they turned, there would be some monarchist so-called structure in Ethiopia, and we know that was established by our godfather, by Kedemawe Haile Selassie. You see what I'm saying? Because we have a little...
The seed of David must remain.
Exactly. And you have to recognize there's some Ethiopian Christians who are more to Wahido Christians or more like Orthodox Christians, right? And they may support the monarchist effort, right? There may be even some Ethiopian Muslims that support the monarchist. I know there are that support the monarchist effort. There's some of us Rastafari, there's 12 tribes, and some of us, even Lion of Judah, we support the monarchist effort. We are not all signed off on, say, Zar Yaakov, because we know that it's about the will of God. But we are not seeking to oppose, you understand, His righteous, to fulfill all righteousness, His effort, you understand, towards bringing that into front and center. And this is where we really need to rally around that while we still, you know, discuss and reason with Zar Yaakov's camp, not with the 12 tribes only, because they're our brothers, but with Zar Yaakov's camp, because his camp is like the imperial council. You understand?
Right.
Issues that concern not just generally Rastafari, because we don't have a general Rastafari kind of anyone who can speak just generally for Rastafari besides His Majesty and His word and will. But the different concerned Rastafari should begin those discussions right now. Even as an individual, we should, you know, contact, like I said, there's a Kebra Neges party. There's a Ning site that we join. Actually, today, was it earlier today? We joined this.
Let me have the name of that site before we finish.
Yeah, it's Kibra Nagast Party, and it's spelled KEBRANAGASTPARTY, and it's a .ning.com site. And we would suggest that ones and ones should sign up to it and get involved, you know, get involved finding out, well, what are they talking about? And we should gather and discuss issues that concern us as Rastafari if we're non-aligned in the sense of 12 tribes. You know, we support 12 tribes, but since we don't speak as a member of the organization called 12 Tribes, you understand, we need to discuss, you know, the elements. I mean, I feel it's a very... You know, this is my personal view of it, but it's a very vibrant time. It's a very dynamic time. It's a very dynamic discussion that we shouldn't lose this opportunity at this time to really, you know, focus on that political area. Because you have to remember that the establishing the Solomonic monarchy, it does more than just put, say, the crown prince, Zar Yaakov, on the throne. It brings into
the children of Rastafari.
Not even Rastafari, it brings the whole Ethiopian Hebrew Israelite, you understand, lost sheep dimension to a whole higher level.
Yeah. As we're saying this now, you know, I'm thinking, my spirit is thinking about, I don't know if you know the Virgin, Brother Ross McPherson.
McPherson, yeah, Ross ESP McPherson, yeah.
Yeah, who's working very strongly on the OAU or the AU now, because he's been, you know, I spoke with him once a good while ago, I got his number and I lost track of, well, you know, I dropped off the radar with him and I really need to get connected up with him again.
Yeah, that's a good brother of mine. I'm actually a member of the EJS, the Ethiopia Jamaica Society. I'm one of the founding, myself and the next, Nigus Amlak is like founding, you know, brethren. Like when that
kaboom.
Yeah, when that organization came about, and that brother, see, I love that brother, and there should be more.
I hope you got his number. I hope you must have his number to give to me, because I know I've lost his number.
And him got to link for a moment, but one thing I love about what he's doing, I'll get his information for you. In fact, you might be even able to research him on the internet. Cause I know I had the internet.
Possibly,
yeah,
because I first heard him on Inner Light Radio.
Yeah, he's out there. We even went to the Ethiopian embassy during the bombardment, during the whole border war conflict that was going on between Ethiopia and Eritrea. We had attended a delegation that was led by Ross ESP McPherson to the Ethiopian consulate to the United Nations a couple of years ago, and that was a very good and vibrant meeting where we presented the what is there to do.